you're at our last stop, just beyond the bridge and the watering trough and the solar collector. Right where the canyon begins to narrow, you'll see a little trail to the left that goes down to the creek. Even if you come in, say, September, when Round Valley is most like a desert, you'll see native rose bushes and pools of life-giving water. Here's Seth Adams.
We're headed east back towards the staging area through the stream canyon. And as soon as we got into the stream canyon, the stream became a ribbon of green vegetation, and there are pools of water on the surface here too, really important for wildlife in the dry season. And I can actually see flow in a few places.
Where there's water and an easy, low-elevation passage through rough country, there's usually wildlife. We're not the only animals affected by gravity.
It's really frequent that you see coyotes in this canyon, but this is also the place where I see the biggest rattlesnakes, 4, sometimes 5 foot long rattlesnakes.
Is there a special time of day where you're most likely to see them?
Out on this east side of the Diablo Range, rattlesnakes are becoming more active as the day goes on rather than less. They wait out the heat of the day, and then they're actually nocturnal a lot out here, hunting during the nighttime. So seeing them in the evening is pretty cool.
If that sounds alarming, don't worry. The rattlesnakes around here aren't aggressive unless you try to handle them or get too close. Their bite is poisonous, but they can only strike half the length of their bodies. For even the biggest rattlers, that's a striking distance of 2 or 2.5 feet. But be careful, especially on rocky areas, and always look before you place your hands on rocks or logs. Basically, snakes just want to be left alone. It's a gift to see one. Another gift you might see around here are frogs and salamanders. Their tadpoles thrive in the creek's quiet pools.
Of course, if you have kids and you see tadpoles in Round Valley Creek, you're probably going to be inclined to let them catch them, but keep in mind that 2 out of the 4 amphibians that you're likely to find in the creek that have tadpoles are likely to be endangered species, red-legged frogs or California tiger salamander.
And that means hands off. Also, keep an eye out for some artfully engineered stream crossings.
There are a couple of different crossings along the creek as you go into the valley, which are interesting to look at, fords and bridges, which are designed with special low-flow culverts through them, so that they don't carve out the creek on the other side and become barriers to the wildlife movement going up the creek.
As you get closer to the staging area, Scott Hine recommends sticking to the trail that hugs the fence line.
This is the point in the hike where you can choose to follow the fire road, which goes stupid steeply up the ridge, and then stupid steeply down the other side of the ridge, where you can hug the fence and follow the path along the fence. And that's what most people do.
In 1.25 miles, you'll find yourself back at the staging area, the last piece of land secured for this park. In our final segment, 8.1, Adams will describe the decade of work that led to opening the park to the public.